welcome to the January 27th edition of Issue That Matter. And I'm not going to have too much verbiage before the show starts because we have an important show for you today. And I have three guests, two guests to speak about the subject, which is the Accessible Home Tax Credit Bill, which is effective today. And we'll be talking about that. And I also have the honor and privilege of having a return guest, this time as a co-host instead of a guest. But Amy, welcome.
Thanks for having me back.
It's an important show that we have today because there is obviously monies out there for people to take advantage of to get tax credits off their main state income tax for modifications made to their home to make them more accessible and or safer. And there is no age limit. Everybody who can demonstrate a need will be eligible. And let me introduce our guests. Arthur Vero, he was a state representative at the time that sponsored the bill. And actually, the bill that passed was very, very similar, and if not identical, to the bill that we tried to get in 2015 and made it all the way to the governor's office and could not get the override of the veto. This year, we played a trick on him. We got the veto overridden. Arthur, welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob.
And Peter Merrill, he's the deputy director of the Maine State Housing Authority. And one of the comment that I will make is that when we made this comment to the Housing Authority about trying to get their involvement in getting this bill through, I had this image of how a state agency was going to respond. And it would be very stoic, very much play by the game, play by the rules, and you're all set, and very formal. The reaction that we got from the Maine Housing Authority was anything but that. They came on board enthusiastically. They saw the value, and I'll let Peter speak to that shortly. They saw the value in it and the value that the citizens of the state would benefit from. So I'm anxious to hear you expound on that. And then we have Amy Gallant, who is the, let me make sure I get this right.
Okay.
Amy is the Maine Advocacy Director for the Association of Retired People, AARP.
AARP. We actually don't go by the whole full Association of Retired Persons anymore. It's just AARP. It makes it easier.
Thank you for the correction.
You're welcome.
Archie, how did you get involved with being a state rep?
Well, thank you for the question, Bob. I served on the Borough City Council for 6 years, and I was a mayor for two terms. Prior to that, I was the city clerk in Borough for 40 years, a long time, career. And then I retired, went into the city council and mayor. And the position in the legislature, representative for Borough, that person that held that position wasn't able to continue on. I think he had some health problems, and so I was somewhat encouraged or recruited to put my name in the hat for that position. And I had been to the legislature before on a number of occasions, testifying on certain bills that related to the city, and so I was somewhat familiar with how things worked in down there in Augusta, and I got a little excited about it. I said, well, why not? I'll try it and see if I like it. So I ran and got elected and served for two terms. And one of the things I was interested in was my work with the city was helping people with their issues and their problems and seeing the community watching as time went by. I noticed more and more elderly people coming to the city for assistance. And I thought, well, this would be a good opportunity for something I could do to help people. And I because they saw that as my mission and my purpose in life somewhat. And I enjoyed working with helping people out. So it kind of come naturally, I guess, coming into the legislature.
What prompted you to get involved with the effort to pass a bill such as the one that passed?
Well, that's a good question. People have asked me that. Noticing friends of mine and other folks in the community struggling with staying in their homes, because in many cases they had two-story houses, the bathroom was on the second floor, bedroom was on the second floor, and people having difficulty because of illness or injury, staying in their home, and they'd be forced to, by necessity, to move out of their homes, and they really didn't want to do that, and their home was the place where they felt most comfortable. And so what could we do to give them some assistance in the state level, giving them some incentive or some help so that they could stay in their homes? And this particular bill was in my work with the local MS society. That's one of the issues that they were concerned about people's mobility, be able to stay in their homes. And I kind of adopted that as one of the things I wanted to see if we could do in the legislature or whatever, some kind of a tax credit or other means of assisting people, keeping them in the home. As we all know, Maine is the oldest per capita, I guess, age in the country, and there's as many people that...
And I would... Yes, age of the population, yes. And also, if I'm not mistaken, which could very well be the case, but I don't think it is in this case, Maine has one of the oldest age of housing in the country.
That's something that we're very concerned about. It depends on which kind of factor you're looking at. We've heard eighth oldest, we've heard fifth oldest housing stock in the country, but you're right. Our homes are old, they are big and drafty and expensive and not very accessible for us as we get older. And something that we hear about at AARP, we've studied it, we have data, but it's also common sense that Mainers want to stay home. They want to stay beside their neighbors in their communities, and they want to do that in a way that's affordable and safe and accessible.
I'm sure we've all seen ads on television about these chairlifts to be able to get a person up and down the stairs. What you don't see on television is how do you get a wheelchair through a doorway that's not wide enough to access that wheelchair.
Or even in the house, if there's stairs, even just a couple stairs to get in. Once you're with someone, if your viewers are watching and thinking, well, I don't have a wheelchair, or my neighbor doesn't have a wheelchair, once you're with someone who has any need for any of these accommodations to prevent falls, to increase movement around the house, to be safer in the kitchen, your eyes are open. I was in D.C., one of my favorite trips to D.C. was with my grampy, and he was in a wheelchair and trying to navigate public transportation with a wheelchair. I've never looked at public transportation the same. My same grampy is still in his home, and it's a big, beautiful old house, and minor accommodations for Grammy and Grampy, things like taking up the rugs, like this kind of area rug, that can prevent falls. That doesn't have a cost. But putting in handrails, or modifying the shower door in some way, or modifying how they're getting in and out of bed, those are low cost, but in some case cost prohibitive modifications that can be made that people like my Grammy and Grampy can stay in their home, and that brings me a lot of relief, and I'm going to see them tonight. As I said, once your eyes are open to that, you really start to understand that this is a huge problem, regardless of age, regardless of where you live in Maine. If you're renting, this tax credit is you're eligible for. If you own a home, if you're looking to buy a home, if you're looking to one day sell your home and downsize, all of these scenarios where Mainers of all ages live, this tax credit is so relevant.
Peter, as Deputy Director of the Maine State Housing Authority, what prompted the Housing Authority to be so enthusiastic about this bill?
Well, we certainly, as Archie said, the state is growing older. The housing stock is growing, it continues to be old. The reason the number fluctuates is we keep building new, and so it just changes every year, which is good.
Good.
Yeah. But it's something we've been looking at for quite a while. And then when we started working with everybody who's involved, it just sparked our staff they just appreciated everybody, how sincere everybody was, and dedicated everybody was, and it just became a real labor of love for everybody. Everybody's worked on it's been very excited about it.
So the bill, how does one go about
The way it works, it's essentially a two-step process. This is a tax credit. It's not a tax deduction. So when you do your taxes, you know, you might deduct your mortgage interest or your state taxes, your local taxes. This is a credit that gets applied to the tax once the tax is determined what you owe. So there are two steps to the process. The first step is with us getting the modification that you make certified, and then the second step is applying for the credit with Maine Revenue Services. So you decide that you need to make your house more accessible. Perhaps your father moves in, he's disabled or whatever. You need to make some accommodations. I would encourage people to take a picture first, a kind of a before and after thing, so it just makes it easier to process. But regardless, you decide what needs to be done. You either can go and purchase the materials and do it yourself if you want to, or you can hire a contractor. I would say that I just want to caution everybody that if you do hire a contractor, state of Maine law requires that any home repair, a renovation that costs more than $3,000 must have a written contract. State law, we're not going to turn somebody down if they didn't do it, but we strongly encourage everybody to do that. The work gets done, then you apply to us, you request us to certify the work. We will issue a certification, assuming it meets all the requirements. Then you'll get a certificate, and then you fill out your tax forms and get the credit there. The tax year, it's like all of your other taxes. If for calendar 2017 you do the work, April 15th, 2018 is when you apply for the credit. And we've tried to be, one of the things that working with all of the advocates that we tried to do that is to be as flexible and make this as easy as possible. So,
well, that's a piece of the puzzle that took me by surprise. In my predetermined view of how a state agency was going to respond to something, that would not be something that I would expect from a state agency.
Right. Well, we clearly can't do if it violates the law. We clearly can't do it. But to the extent that there's room to interpret it, there's room, you know, and when we wrote the rule, we tried to be as general as possible. The law said that you must pick a standard and say what that standard is going to be. We did that, but a lot of these standards are very strict. And the federal government enforces them very strictly. So if you're supposed to have a rail on, say, a multifamily apartment building, and the rail has to be between 36 and 38 inches off the ground, if it's 35, the regulators come in and tell you you have to move it. So what we said, we don't really, doing that with some poor individual, it's terrible. So we want to use these as a guideline, but not as a strict standard. And that's the approach we've taken to do this.
Yeah. So we've talked a couple of examples, just kind of throwing them out here. Can you say a little bit more about the kind of work that is eligible for this credit?
Let me
reference the rule.
The rule lists 18 or 19 items, and it would make more sense if I just read a few of them. So you had mentioned flooring, mm-hmm. changes to flooring so that to avoid a tripping hazard, light switches, moving the light switches from up here to down here. Your walkway outside, if it's you got bumpy bricks or something, you might want to smooth that out. You might want to put a ramp in. You might need an accessible parking spot out front. You might want to make changes in your kitchen, bring the counters down, have front knobs on the stove, that sort of thing. You might put levers or latches on the door rather than a doorknob. The roll-in showers, I think you had mentioned, grab bars. Grab bars is another great example of where the regulation says that the grab bar must be here and it must be at this angle and that sort of thing. And one of the things that it was clear that we were headed in the right direction. Some of our technical guys came into the office and we were talking about how to do this. And one of them said, the one thing we would just really request is that you not make these things hard and fast. And one of the guys started talking about his parents, and what his dad really needed was a grab bar that it was this angle to get him out of the tub, and that was mm-hmm. what really would work best for him. The regulation says it has to be at this angle, and so it's like, yeah, we're all there. So that's the kind of right. thing. But those are a few examples of the things, seats for the tub. Lifts. We talked about lifts earlier. Those kinds of things.
Well, I had the opportunity to sit in on some of the meetings that took place, and again, I was blown away. I was blown away by the enthusiasm demonstrated by people on your staff,
yeah.
Which was so far different from what I would have expected.
Yeah. Well,
from
thank
a state
you.
Agency.
Thank you. It was fun to do.
And I love
hopefully it'll work out. I mean, hopefully it'll be popular and mm-hmm. they'll it'll mm-hmm. get a lot of
I can think traction. Of no good reason why it wouldn't be.
No, I can't either.
Now, Archie, you've got some personal relativities, you might say, to the issue. What drove you personally to get involved in something like this?
As I mentioned, I was involved with the MS Society, the different groups that we have around the state, and went to a lot of their meetings, and I guess what I saw there was and what I heard was people talking about, particularly like bathrooms were a big issue. A lot of accidents happen because we're falling out of a tub or falling in the tub or something mm-hmm. like that, and I thought people should be able to live safely in the house. So they want to live there. They don't want to move. They want to stay there. They're comfortable there. They feel safe there. What can we do to, give them some support? And over time, I know that I have myself. I have MS, and I have. To walk with a cane and a walker in the house sometimes, but I always worry about falling. And not only, I'm not just talking about the MS Society, but there are other folks that have other ailments, Parkinson's disease or something. So this whole group of people I'm concerned about, and as people age and as they have accidents, perhaps. Mm-hmm. They need something to help them stay in their home.
You just mentioned something that I think is important to bring up and make clear. Yes, if a person has MS or Parkinson's or any number of other potential illnesses, they would qualify. But you don't need to have an illness such as that in order to qualify.
Right, that's true.
The fact that you're elderly and you have difficulty getting around is qualification enough.
Right.
So don't think that you have to have a particular illness to hamper you. No. If you're older and you have difficulty getting around, that qualifies you.
That's true. That's a good point, Bob.
And I'm really proud of that. I think that too often we inadvertently pit very worthy groups against each other in a legislative process, and it happens time and time again, and we didn't do that this time, I think, because you were so dedicated. The committee, the taxation committee, was very, and then the appropriations committee were very dedicated to keeping the legislative language broad, and the coalition that supported this bill included MS, Alpha One, AARP, and others who understand exactly what you're talking about, Bob, that yes, there are diagnosable illnesses with, therefore you need XYZ technology. Okay, but there are many, many Mainers who don't have a slip from their doctor saying you must have this technology or this modification. And when we looked around, and particularly engaging Alpha One, and saw that yes, there are currently available programs and funds for people with very specific disabilities, we wanted to make sure that this bill stayed true to really the spirit of what we were all coming together to do, which was put a little bit more behind some of the currently available programs, right, and fill some of the gaps, which is people just wanting to stay home.
Yep. I mean, the fact is, you know, why would you make an accessibility improvement to your home if it wasn't necessary?
Right.
I mean, really, you know?
And the fact that it's a credit means that people have to put the money out.
You have to put the money out first. Right. I will say that there are two things I think probably should be mentioned. One is that the legislature put $1 million per year cap on the program. That helped the political process. It made it more palatable and easier to pass. The experience we've seen around the country is that I don't think that's going to get hit. I don't think that's going to be a problem at all. However, if Maine Revenue is going to have to keep track of that, and if you're the million and $1 person, you're going to have to wait until the next year. I would also say that the credit can be taken over a period of years. If you have a credit of $3,000, but you only owe $1,000 in taxes, you take the credit and then you apply it to future years. The other thing I think I want to make sure we note is that the legislature wanted, the tax committee wanted to make sure that we did do some oversight, some auditing, and so if we get a request to make a certification that sounds fishy, obviously we're gonna check on it. But we will be randomly auditing a certain percentage of the jobs that are done, just to ensure that somebody's looking over the shoulder and that the state's not getting taken for a ride.
Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit more about what that means if someone's listening and watching and thinking, well, I don't really know what an audit of my bathroom modification means? What does that look
really,
like?
Really, it means that one of our inspectors would come by and, not unexpected, but, you know, would call up and say, I'd like to come by and inspect the work that was done for the tax credit, and arrange a time to come and visit, and the homeowner would, or a taxpayer would show them what was done. Here's where we did the grab bars. Here's the ramp we put in. Whatever it is, mm-hmm. And hopefully they've got a before picture. But whatever it is, just show the work, and we'll say thank you very much, and that'll be that.
That's great.
Yeah. That's the sort of thing. Now, if somebody's trying to, build a new house, and I don't know, it's pretty clear they either don't understand it or mm-hmm. just trying to take it for a ride, then we might go out and look at it as well. So we have any number of we have wide latitude about how and when we will choose to do that, but they did want us to have some oversight on that.
Now, I want to make clear that we got this bill through in 2016. We did propose a bill, Representative Vero proposed a bill back in 2015, which met with very good response in the House, very good response in the Senate, but it went to the governor's desk. He vetoed it. We were not able to override the veto. We went through much of the same process in 2016, except this time we got the veto overridden. One of the things that remained the same between 2015 and 2016 was the involvement and the support of AARP.
Yep.
And I can't speak strongly enough about the value of the support that AARP has offered, their guidance. They are outstanding in being able to negotiate through what could be a very complex process. I spent a good share of time up at the State House over the past 2 years, and it is complex. It is very complex.
That's polite.
So, Amy, I want to thank you for your efforts.
My pleasure.
And having AARP as part of the team, and I would venture to say more involved in the team this year than it was in past year, in the previous year. And I think that made a big difference. I think it made the team that much more effective. Right. And this year we were able to put together a very good team. And I'm proud to say that we had the Maine Housing Authority on the team this year. And your support was invaluable.
Thank you.
Let me just say something about complexity. And you mentioned that.
Yep.
And it was indeed a learning experience and a very complex. It took us, 18 months to get this bill through. We had a lot of meetings with legislative councils on both Democrats and Republicans. I think that went very well. We kept the iron hot, and we had good support from AARP, Alpha One, the Maine State Housing, and other folks that came forward, maybe by letters or contacting their individual members of the legislature. So when we went to the Appropriations Committee, we requested more money, and the Appropriations Committee had a large table of bills to consider funding, and they couldn't fund everything. We kept working at that and kept in contact with people on that committee and saying, well, if you can't give us this large amount that we want, this larger amount, can you give us something just to get the program started? And I think that's the approach that we were willing to not demand too much, and to get the bill passed and to get this program underway. Like, as I mentioned, it's kind of a pilot project. Let's get it started, open the door a little bit, and in future years we can enhance it with a little more money perhaps if we need to. And
Here's what you did there are two roles you played that were both invaluable. One is the inspiration to have the to go out and fight the battle and see the cause and that it's done. But this whole appropriating process that you talk about is very much a behind the scenes sort of process and something that goes on at the end of the legislative session, and it's very difficult. And your work with members of that committee, the kind of the second committee review that it had to go through to get them to come up with that was probably much more challenging than the work with the tax committee. And your work with the chairs and the leads and everybody else on the committee to get that through really, I think, paid off. That's what it takes.
Well, it was as I said, an interesting and challenging process, meeting with the chair people of the Appropriations Committee, chasing them down, and one of the committee members said, don't give up, keep, mm-hmm. you know, every time you see me, ask me about mm-hmm. that bill, mm-hmm. and, you know, how important it is, and that process, and I don't want to neglect mentioning that we had good support from people in the other party. I'm a Democrat, but we had particularly Representative Stedman Seavey mm-hmm. from mm-hmm. Kennebunkport. Yep. Mm-hmm. He was very instrumental. When it came to the House for the vote on overriding the veto, I spoke, Representative Seavey spoke, and we had two representatives, that one Democrat and one Republican, who were wheelchair bound, and they both spoke very eloquently about the importance of that bill, and I could just feel the whole mm-hmm. the whole House kind of, we had their attention, mm-hmm. and we were able to override that governor's veto mm-hmm. By unanimous votes in both mm-hmm. the House and the Senate, which was probably something that doesn't happen very often, mm-hmm. and everybody felt good about it, and I felt like shouting when we took the vote, and then I thought, I don't want to jeopardize somebody else's bill that's coming up for override, but I have to, you know, commend the other members of the legislature because they all voted for it.
Absolutely.
So, this is
and it makes it easy when everyone votes for it, because it's not too late for constituents to call and thank their representative. We don't have to go back to the roll call and say, these did, these didn't. This bill transcended party politics and overriding vetoes. Some of them were not overridden. Many of them were not overridden. And this was, and it was really exciting. I remember sitting in the Senate, and everyone was smushed in in the House, you sit in individual seats, and in the Senate, you sit on benches for the most part. So everyone squeezes in, and when it came up on the screen to override the veto, I kind of reached out like this and could, you know, grab onto probably 10 people in total, and I said, "This is our bill," and it was unanimous, and I felt the same way. I wanted to clap, and it was kind of in the last days of the session, and it was just such an exciting process. And because it was unanimous, I encourage everyone, anyone, to reach out to their legislator, even if they're new, and say, I know this was a vote last year, but I just heard about it, and I want to thank you for it because it's important to me and my neighbors and my community, maybe my parents, my grandparents, whomever it may be. It's never too late to thank a legislator.
It does raise the question that I've answered my own mind as to why would the governor veto this bill when it's received such overwhelming support in both the House, unanimous support in the Senate? What would cause the governor to veto this bill? He's already made comment that he wants to keep people in their homes.
Wasn't that veto, though, I think that was a period of time where he was vetoing everything because they were, the legislature and the governor were just not agreeing.
You're being kind. I look at it and I say, the reason he vetoed it is because he knew it was going to get approved. He knew the veto was going to be overridden. I would call it plausible deniability. He knew that it was going to be overridden, so if he was ever questioned about it in the future, he would say, hey, I didn't pass that bill. I vetoed it. The legislature passed the bill.
Yeah.
They overrode my veto. Don't blame me.
Well, I'm glad that you reminded us that the governor does repeatedly say that seniors are a top priority for him.
That's right.
And I think even though this did not pass with his signature on it, it's okay. It passed.
That's right.
Seniors benefit.
It was great news, and it gave me a great feeling knowing that I was involved in the process. Mm-hmm. Only surpassed by the feeling that I have from being able to work through this process with such dedicated people. Amy, Peter, Archie, the three of you demonstrated your dedication to this effort. I would include Stedman Seavey in that. Mm-hmm. As well as a lot of other people mm-hmm. along the way. Alpha One.
Yes, absolutely.
They're with
Dennis.
Us every step of the way, and I look forward to having continued excellent relationships with everybody on the team. I got to know one of the advantages that I experienced personally is I got to know people who were so dedicated in what they do and knowledgeable about what they do. It was inspiration. It was an inspiration to be able to work with such people.
That's great.
Well, I think Dennis from Alpha One really brought a lot of content and understanding about what's currently available and where some of those gaps are that we talked about earlier. So I always enjoy working with Dennis, and this was no exception. And then the team at the MS Society were just fantastic. I mean, yes, volunteers here on the ground, but volunteers here on the ground and people doing this work in multiple states. And I know what a challenge both of those dynamics are. And I thought you were going to say it was that moment was second to the recognition in the House of the MS Day. There was a day, I can't remember what order did this bill pass, and then a couple days, weeks later, we had a House proclamation that you were all up in the gallery, the MS Society was all up in the gallery, and the whole House stood up and clapped, and it was just one of those really nice moments that despite how discouraged people can feel and about politics, that was a really wonderful, genuine moment. And I posted a picture of the MS Society on Facebook, and it's the most likes that I've ever had on any Facebook page. So despite the good legislative work we do together, you make me much more popular on Facebook too. So thank you for that. All these things are important.
Well, you know, there was interest in the session on elderly and keeping people in
Keep
their
me
homes.
Home.
And that was part of Speaker Eves and then Senator Burns were chairing that committee. And we had several meetings on that. We talked about different ideas about what we could do. And so this kind of fit in naturally with that. And I think it sort of got caught up in the wave of that support. And well, that was helpful too as well, because there was a lot of attention paid to people, keeping people in their homes, where they're safer and they're happier and healthier.
Okay. One of the experiences that I had, which has stuck with me, and a lot of experiences that I've had don't stick with me because my memory is so bad, but this one stuck with me. I remember I was up there for one of the hearings in front of the Taxation Committee, and I was having lunch with a group of representatives on the Taxation Committee, and they were telling me how this bill is going to go, it's going to fly right through, no problem, don't worry about it, all this other stuff. And then we got into the hearing, and I was up there to answer their questions. I got bombarded with these questions that I was not able to answer. So that, but at the end of the day, they all fell in line. My sense was then, and I continue to think this, that they just wanted to make sure before this bill went to the House, before this bill went to the floor, that all the I's were dotted and all the T's were crossed, and that nobody's going to be asking, was going to be able to ask a surprise question that they didn't already have an answer to.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's right.
So that's part of how the process works, and it's a process that I'm not all that familiar with.
Yeah.
So they caught me by surprise. But they ruined my lunch that day.
Yeah, the Taxation Committee was very, very good. I think we appeared before them three times on this bill because they would ask for additional information. We would go out and get that information, bring it back, and satisfy that committee, and they were very supportive all the way through. So
the other thing we did.
Now, what was probably the biggest challenges that you faced
on that
whole process?
That bill, I guess getting the word out as to what this would do and how it would be effective and help people. So going over that, crossing over that bar, I guess, to convince people that may have had some doubts about it, had some questions about it, and getting that education education out, and I think it worked. I mean, we had a lot of we had a lot of support, a lot of people coming from different areas contacting their legislators. That's, you know, I never am really confident about a bill because, and there were a couple of amendments that came through at the last minute, something to do with the way the bill, the legislation was introduced, and that was okay. We were able to work through those and get to the goal line with carrying the football and like the Patriots. It was like a Super Bowl thing, so that was good.
If there was one thing, I'm going to ask you each of you with the same question. So for the people that are not asked first, be ready.
Okay.
If there was one thing that you would want to have people take as a takeaway from our conversation this morning, what would that one thing be?
What I can think of is that the legislature cares about citizens, and particularly, you know, older citizens and people with disabilities that come away thinking, feeling good about what the legislature has done. Not just with this bill, but with other bills that were helpful to for people. So that's what I would.
I think that speaks to, and this is a belief that I have, that we get too log jammed up with the route that we want to take. We have the same goal. We want to get to the same place. Yeah. Where we differ is in the route that we take. Yeah. And we get log jammed because we have differences in the route, which puts the goal, which otherwise would be within reach, out of reach. And I could say this about at the state level, and I can certainly say it about it at the national level. I think we get too lost in the minor points, you might say, and we lose sight of the goal. And so my takeaway in that regard is, do not lose sight of the goal.
Because something can always go wrong, you know, and that's, we just have to work through that process and answer people's questions so that people are satisfied with and feel comfortable with passing the bill, and I think they did in this case.
Peter, what would be your takeaway?
I would say I would encourage people not to be reluctant to use this. If you make less than $55,000 a year, you can take advantage of this program. And people are oftentimes reluctant to do that. But call us up, ask about it, see if it might work for you, and don't be afraid to try and take advantage of it.
Based on what you just said, my takeaway on that point would be, do not fear the Maine State Housing Authority.
That's a good one.
Your new logo.
They are actually out there to help you.
That's right.
Yes.
Much more so than what a lot of people might think of a state agency wanting to do.
But we do find with a number of our programs, like fuel assistance, for instance, that many people who qualify do not want to ask or go through the process. Mm-hmm. And you right. try and make the process as, to the extent it's within your control, mm-hmm. you try and make it as easy as possible. And that's what we've done here. And so we, like I said, we would encourage people to take advantage of it if they can.
Amy?
Well, I'll build on Peter's last point there, that many Mainers don't take advantage of the support services that we have and the programs that we have available. And that only increases as the age increases. Older Mainers are the least likely to go on the internet and say, you know what, I need $500
right.
back on my taxes to be able to offset this current cost to make sure that I don't fall getting out of the bathtub again. And we need your help. We need everyone listening and watching to help us increase awareness of this new program, of existing programs. Peter spoke earlier about the fact that other states haven't even come close to spending $1 million on this program every year. And it's because, it's not because homes don't need to be modified. It's because people don't know about the program or don't think they're eligible or have questions and don't know who to ask. So those would be my takeaways, to help us increase awareness, use it yourself, as you said, but also to help be our megaphone and watch this program and pass it on and tell your neighbors who you might know are planning to do some home modifications, if only they had a little bit of financial support in the form of a tax credit. We really need your help getting this information out. And Maine Housing has done a beautiful job putting together very easy to access, easy to read information. We're not just going on the internet, although there's plenty of information on the website. We want to make sure that where people are who would be eligible and interested in and needing to access this program, we have pamphlets, we have brochures, we have press release, we have letters to the editor, whatever we need to do to build that bridge between the hard work at the legislature to even the harder work of actually implementing this thing and making sure that people are getting money back in their pockets starting a year from now. That's where we are now. We really need help getting the word out and building that bridge.
Now, for those of you who are computer literate and are used to working on the internet, the web address for the Maine Housing Authority is www.mha.com. .org.
MaineHousing.org.
There's my error for the day.
I always
make a mistake somewhere in the show. That was my mistake for the day.
Let's do it again.
20 or 30 years ago, we discovered that there's some Manitoba health agency that has the same initials. So,
interesting.
So it's www.mainhousing.org.
That's what I have typed in here, but I just read it.
MaineHousing.org.
MaineHousing.org. And all the information that anything you might want to know about this tax credit is on that website.
Yep.
So take advantage of it.
Yep.
Perfect.
And with that, I want to thank my guests, our guests. I very much look forward to working with you folks off into the future. I'm sure we'll be in contact with you. The fact that you and I have already talked about something that we might have contact on that might be coming up in the house.
Yep.
I cannot express my appreciation and my gratitude, if I can be redundant, for the work that you folks have done, that you did this past year, as well as in 2015. It was inspirational. To see the team come together as it did was something to behold. I'm deeply appreciative on a personal level, because I might someday be a personal, be able to take advantage of it personally. Right now, I'm not in a position where I need to. But so the day's coming soon where I'm gonna have to put that chairlift in.
All of us, I'm afraid, except maybe Amy.
Someday.
That's right, someday.
Yeah.
But I've gotten to know the three of you quite well over the course of time. I look forward to working with you in the future. And I thank you very much for being the guest on my show today. Have a great day,
folks. Thank you very much.
Hope you enjoyed the show. It's chock full of information. Take advantage of the information that was imparted to you today, and go on the website to check out the Maine Housing Authority website and see what else you can find out. Have a great day. Make it a safe day, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.